Hello, this is Rohan Paul. Very welcome to my machine learning and deep learning YouTube channel. Let's get started.
So today I'll be doing this project in this video of predicting the transaction value of a potential customer of a bank. And for this, we already have a very famous Kaggle competition that was hosted in 2018 named Santander Value Prediction Challenge. And here the competition host is asking data scientists to come up with a number or predicted value of transaction of its potential customers so that the bank can personalize the services to a huge customer base at scale.
But before I start, a quick word that in this channel, over the next few months, I'm going to do a lot of full-scale projects in the space of data science and deep learning, especially focusing on Kaggle competition and Kaggle challenges. And also, I'm going to upload videos pretty frequently, 2 times to 3 times each week. So if you have not subscribed yet, do subscribe. And if you like the video at the end, do not forget to hit the like button. All right, with that, let's do the actual work.
So let's first get the business problem here that for a bank, one of the paramount problem is predicting the transaction value of a new or potential customer. Because if as a bank, I can predict the number or the transaction value of a potential customer, then I can personalize the bank services accordingly. Now, this is the main Kaggle page of this competition, Santander Value Prediction Challenge, and I am in the overview page. It very clearly says that in this competition, Santander Group is asking Kagglers to help them identify the value of transaction for each potential customer. This is a first step that Santander needs to nail in order to personalize their services at scale. Okay, this is the main target, main motivation of this challenge. And so now if you go to the data tab, this is the most important part for doing our entire work. So we have been given two sets of data set, test.csv and train.csv. I'm just clicking on the train.csv. So this is a tabular data set, and the most important two columns are these ID, which represent each individual or each customer, and this target variable is what we need to predict. So this is train.csv I'm looking at. So I already have the target variable been given. And so for example, for the first row, for this particular ID, this value is a predicted transaction value. And now if you look at the data set, one specialty of this data set is that it's completely anonymous. That is, all the feature names are anonymized. Means, look at these features. Like, we only know the ID and the target, and the rest all are like this. 48DF8869 is one of feature name. Then the next one is like this. And if you go further down, further right, actually, see all these feature names. They're just numbers and letters combination. No names, no meaning whatsoever. So what it means is that a feature variable comes with no description whatsoever, and with anonymized names like these, it provide little meaning to us as data scientists. So as a data scientist, when I want to work with these data or predict some numbers for the target variable, I really want to understand all these feature names ideally. That is, they should have a proper definition, proper explanation, so that I can make use of some sophisticated feature engineering technique or similar things like that. But here for this particular challenge, probably I can just guess that these feature names probably possibly are aggregated transaction, maybe by day, by week, or by month, or maybe they are individual transaction which could be further grouped by some other financial instrument. For example, maybe they are grouped by debit card or credit card or loans, but I have no clear definition. So in the ideal case, you as a data scientist never want to work with this kind of data, but this is the constraint here. Although we would like to have meaning and definition for these feature names, but we don't have it. So this is the constraint, and we have to predict our model based on this data set itself. Because in this case, even the competition host, the Santander Group, can't help much here. And the main reason is that for most companies, especially for financial companies and banks, the data they possess is a valuable asset. and that cannot be compromised. And this is probably the best that Santander can do to make this data available to public for a Kaggle competition or things like this, because otherwise they would never get the approval for their legal or compliance team to make some data available publicly. It would either the data that they can share with us to the world, it would either be obfuscated data like this or no data at all that can be made publicly available. So hence the overall point is that this competition doesn't seem to offer a lot of room for either sophisticated models or smart feature engineering employing domain knowledge, because all the features are anonymized. But even we, I don't know if there is a data leak or similar kind of property that is there hidden in the data set. But anyway, this is a constraint. So let's start working with this data itself. And another characteristics of this data set is that it is extremely sparse. That is, most values are zero. So if you go all the way right back, I can only see too many zeros all over. So this is an extremely sparse data set. So anyway, this target is our target variable that we have to predict, and this values that this target variable can take, these are continuous values. So the problem here we are dealing with is one of regression, and this is so overall it becomes a regression problem on a very sparse and anonymized data set. Now let's begin. And also the evaluation for this competition is RMSLE and not RMSE. That is, RMSLE stands for root mean squared logarithmic error, which is slightly different than root mean square error. We'll come to that in a second. So this is a formula for RMSLE, and so this is the evaluation matrix for this competition, and you can go there. The definition is also given here clearly. This is just a standard classical definition of RMSLE, where the epsilon, this term, is an error, which is this full expression on the right side, and the n is, that is, this n is a total number of observations or total number of rows that you are given, and p underscore i here is the your prediction of target, predicted value of target, and ai is the actual target, and log x is a natural logarithm of x. So we have two logarithms here, one for log pi plus one and also for ai plus one. And it is important to understand the differences between these two loss measures, the RMSLE, which is applicable for this competition, and RMSE. So both of these formulas are here. It's pretty simple, pretty standard formulation here, but let's understand the actual significance between these differences. So I have made this quick presentation slide for the differences between RMSE versus RMSLE. So in the cases of RMSE, the presence of outliers can explode the error term to a very high value, but in the case of RMSLE, the outliers are drastically scaled down, therefore nullifying their effect. Evaluation metric RMSLEs are usually used when you do not want to penalize huge differences in the predicted and the actual values, and when both predicted and the actual values are large numbers. Also, RMSLE explodes in magnitude as soon as it encounters an outlier, which is, of course, coming from the first point. So, but in contrast, even on the introduction of the outlier, the RMSLE error is not affected much. And number two is RMSLE metric only considers a relative error between the predicted and the actual value, and the scale of the error is not significant. On the other hand, RMSE value increases in magnitude if the scale of error increases. So overall, RMSLE is especially useful for business cases where the underestimation of the target variable is not acceptable, but overestimation can be tolerated. And that makes sense for this challenge here, because think about it from the perspective of a bank, that if the predicted value of a customer is underestimated by our machine learning model, that cannot be tolerated, because in that case I will lose out on a potential good customer for which I could have some personalized services. But a little bit of overestimation can be tolerated, because if overestimate means that I will overestimate the transaction value of a customer, and thereby I will provide him with some personalized services which will just go waste, because that actually that that isn't, that was an overestimation of the value that the customer will bring to the bank. And so this really logically and conceptually makes sense to use RMSLE for this challenge. And also remember that here the outlier effect will be there for the target variable, because the target variable varies extremely depending on the customer. So I think I will probably go over the actual range of values in a second, but the target variable can be sometime like $10,000 to up to $17 million. So the outlier is too much in this data set, and so that's another reason to use RMSLE for the loss metric. And this is the overall plan for doing this project now. That so we have been given two data set, train CSV and test CSV. So first I will do little bit of data pre-processing before actually employing the model, and with those pre-processing are removing all the duplicate columns, and also I'll be removing all the constant variance columns. And then remember, I already discussed it is an extremely sparse data set, so I'm going to remove columns with only sparse data. And then I will split the train.csv into train and test segment using the scikit-learn train test split function. And then I will be using applying three models, LightGBM, CatBoost, and XGBoost, all boosting three famous gradient boosting algorithm. And then finally, I will do an ensemble model out of the training from these three models. And that ensemble model is the one that will be my final prediction, which will be applied on the test data set and also finally submitting to the Kaggle competition. So if you want to do the actual coding in the Kaggle kernel itself, you can just go to this competition page and code, and you can click on new notebook, and that will create a new kernel, and in that you can import this data and start coding. But normally what I do for any Kaggle competition or any projects for that matter is I download the full data into my local machine and then start my coding. And finally, when I'm done in the working at my local machine then I upload the kernel in Kaggle. But because this is not a huge data set as such, so I do not need a very powerful GPU. So this is 1.08 GB, but indeed the train CSV is just 65.16 MB, so it is very reasonable, very small size data set compared to many other Kaggle competition. You can very easily handle this data in your local machine. So what you have to do first, just download the whole data set. You can download individually from here by clicking on this download icon for train data set, test data set, and simple and sample submission. All three you need indeed. So yeah, so let's go to my VS Code. All right, so this is my VS Code, and so the first cell of these VS Code is just all the regular imports, that is NumPy, Matplotlib, and all the modules of sklearn. Especially you can imagine all the standard module like train, test, split, etc. And the one thing to note here is that I'll be using LightGBM, XGBoost, and CatBoost in this project, and so I'm importing these three libraries, LightGBM, XGBoost, and CatBoost. And then the next cell, like I said again, that I already have downloaded the data from Kaggle to my local machine, and in this cell I'm just reading them. So this is my path of the two data set, train CSV and test CSV, and with the read CSV function of pandas, I am just reading and then printing the head of those data set. So this head prints the five rows of the train, and just as you expect, that all the feature names are anonymized, and these two feature names, that is ID and target, ID is just represent each individual customer, because each of these row actually represent each potential customer identified by a unique ID, and the target is the predicted transaction value of that particular customer. And the rest, all these headings, all these column names are anonymized, they are our actual feature. And so that was my train. It has got total 4993 columns. So if you deduct ID and target, we are actually meaningful features are 4991. And now that I'm printing the test df.head. This is my test data set. And again, this test data set has only one difference, that it definitely would not have the target as one of the column, because it's test, it the target is what we are supposed to predict. So it has one less column compared to the trained data set. Otherwise, we have IDs here as well, and all the features again. So in the next cell, I'm just printing the shape to check out the shape. So the train has 4,459 rows and 4,993. So notice these speciality of this data set, that is, it is wider than it is lengthier. That is, the number of rows are actually less than the number of features. Very special. You don't get to see this kind of data set pretty often. All right. But anyway, we have to work with this in this case. And the test data set has a reasonably good structure. We have 49,000 plus rows and 4,992 features. Now let's do the pre-processing on our data set. But before starting the data pre-processing, quickly go over the overall characteristics of our data set. That we have 4,459 rows in train set and 49,340 rows in test set. So our test set is almost 10 times bigger than a train set. And then in the train data set, the number of column is more than the number of train rows. So our data set is wider than it is tall. So we need to be careful with feature selection and feature engineering, because it's a peculiar, it's a very special kind of structure that you don't see very often. And then we have an anonymized ID feature together with a numerical target variable. The typical values of this target variable seem to be relatively high. And the remaining 4,991 features, that is excluding ID and a target, now we are completely given an anonymized data, which is primarily integer or double format. Now you can actually quickly do test, check out the overall information of the data set by using this function tf.info. Let's see what this prints. Okay, so this test data set, range index 49342, yeah, column 4992 entries like we expected, and D types, data types are mostly float 64, and we also have object. And do the same for my train data set. So in the train as well, I have 4,459 entries. D types are distributed among float 64, int 64, and object. Memory usage is much less because it's a much lesser data set, 169.9 MB. All right, I am now going to do a scatter plot on the target variable value, so I can check the distribution or the range of the target variables. So this is my code. And a quick note that I'm not going to type the values, type the code here, because that will make the video length incredibly long, and that is not a proper use of your time. So I already have these, I already have coded this notebook in a separate file, and I'm just copying this code from there to here. So this code is pretty simple. I'm just making use of the scatter function of matplotlib and passing the values of the target variable from my train data set. And if I execute this cell, I will get this plot. And from the plot, you can see that the range of the target variable is really high. So now I want to do a histogram of the target variable to check their actual distribution. All right, this is my code for histogram. Again, this is I'm using the SNS hist plot function, and then to hist plot I am passing the entire values of my target variables from the train DF, which is my train data set. And executing this code will give me this plot. All right, so now this is my histogram of all the target variables, and as you can see, this plot is actually very much right skewed. Most of the values are in this range, which is a low range, and very small percentage is in the very high value range. So, and that's what we are discussing, that in this competition, the value range of target variables is really high. That is, there's the chances of outlier in my predictions. And this is another reason that to use RMSLE as a loss function or the loss metric to evaluate the prediction. So let's now do another histogram with log value of target variables. So to use a log value of the target variable, this is a code. The only difference with the previous code is that here I was passing the train df and then the target dot values, that is actual target values, the absolute values. But here I am making use of the np.log1p to take the logarithm, natural logarithm of the absolute values of target, and then I'll be plotting the histogram. So if I run this code, this is the plot I'm getting. Now this is actually more meaningful because now with the log, the extreme values get normalized a little bit, and I can see a more significant representation of the values of the target. And now I want to check for null values in the data. And now I just want to check the null values. And for this is my code. That is, I'm pretty simple line of code. Just the first line will give me the total size of the null values in the entire data set. So what I'm basically doing here, that I am first within this part of the code, I am checking the total count of null values in the entire train df. And in my comment, I've already put that to get the total number of null values, you have to use this kind of function application, that is data frame into data frame dot is null dot sum. And but from the total columns of my train df, I only want to extract those columns which has got no null values, and that's what I'm using these condition here, that these is null should not be zero and only give me those column, and then applying size function to get the size of that many number of columns. And so overall, these entire piece of code will just give me the total number of columns which has null values inside them. And if you run this code, I will get a zero. So that means this entire data frame does not have any NaN values or is null values. All right, now the next step, I want to discard all the constant variance features. So variance measures particular features range of values, that is how much it is varying from the mean value of that feature. Now by going by the normal statistical intuition, if a variable has very low variance, sorry, if a feature has very low variance, then that particular feature is very less important in contributing to the model prediction. This is kind of the rule of thumb or the normal statistical intuition, but it always is not absolutely 100% true, or you don't have to follow it blindly always, because in many deep learning models and many gradient boosting model, these issues are already taken care of. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to only discard only those features who are constant. That is, they have a variance of zero. They don't change at all. That means they are practically constant. That means they have no contribution to the model prediction. So let's do that. And here is my code for that. So basically what I'm doing here is I'm extracting all the column names which are constant, which have zero variance and zero standard deviation, that means. And then I will be removing those columns from both train df and test df. So quickly understand this code, very simple code here. What I'm doing is just looping through all the column names in my train df with the first line. And then I am checking that this entire variance calculation is not done on ID and target column, because ID is represent my unique IDs of each customer. So I do not want to definitely I do not want to touch them, even if they are duplicated. In case they are duplicated, I do not want to touch them for now, for this particular step. And target is obviously my target, so I do not want to run any check on that as well, because they may be duplicated, because two customers may have the same transaction value. So anyway, so and in that I'm just checking that each column, the STD, the standard deviation, should be equal to zero. So make a note of these, that I'm checking only those column names whose entire values are the standard deviation of all the values are exactly equal to zero. Only those columns I want to completely remove from my training data set. And this line is doing that. Std equal to zero, and then I am appending that particular column names to these variable const columns to remove, which I have declared at the top. And then with these steps, I will have my, when this loop is done for the entire train df, I will have my const columns to remove. We'll have the entire all the column names which are constant, which don't change, and then I can just remove them with the drop function, train df dot drop and train df dot drop. And I'm doing that in place, and just to check out that it's working, I'm printing here the constant columns to remove. So let's run this cell. Oops, it did not run properly. Let's check out. Okay, now it ran successfully. All right, now see, I just printed the total number of constant columns to remove and the length of this actually. So 256 constant columns, that's what this code found. So we had, I think total number of features are 4993. Out of that, ID and target you can omit. And so we had 4991 features. Out of that, 256 constant where features were just constant. They were not changing at all. And now that I am removing, so after removing, that is after doing these drop, applying this drop function, the updated shape of my train df would be 4459 rows, which remains the same, and the number of columns, that is the number of features, reduced by these 256. So this is updated feature number, and this data is, this train and test data is will be my final data set on which I'll be running the training. All right. And now the next step is to remove all the duplicated columns, if there is any duplicate columns indeed. So I'll be making use of two functions of pandas. One is duplicated and the LOC function. So let's quickly check out how duplicated works before understanding this piece of code. So I have put the detailed comment here. You can just read the comment that pandas duplicated function, that is when you apply it on df.columns.duplicated, it returns a boolean array, that is a true false array. So if the column name is unique, so this duplicated will move through each column name starting at the leftmost position and moving towards right, and if a column name is unique up to that point, then it will return false. And if the column name is duplicated earlier, it will return true. That's what the duplicated function will do. So for example, let's say I have this array alpha beta alpha. If I apply df.columns.duplicated on these, that is, for example, this is a column name. So, and if I apply duplicated on these, it will return me false because this is not duplicated. Then the next one is also not duplicated. And the third one is duplicated earlier. So this will return true. So false, false, true. That will be my return value after applying duplicated function of pandas on this. But in this case, after I find duplicated in this way, then I have to only return unduplicated column names ultimately. So I have to flip this value. That is where this duplicated function returns me false. That means it is actually unduplicated. I have to flip this to true, because then the LOC function of pandas will return me that true valued columns, because pandas allows one to index using boolean values whereby it selects only the true values. This is, I'm talking about the LOC function. Since we want to keep the unduplicated columns, we need the above boolean array to be flipped. That is true, true, false. That is what I'm saying here is this false, false, true need to be flipped to true, true, false. So let's actually check the code, then it will be all clear. Okay, this is my code, and I'll just look at the first line here. So my new train df is after removing all the duplicated column names. So first I'm capturing all the duplicated column names and then flipping these with this tilde symbol, and then I'm capturing the totality of this with the LOC function, which uses to index my data frame and return me. So basically, ultimately, this whole line of code will give me all the unduplicated column names. Now, actually, this line of code will give me the data frame after removing all the duplicated column names. So this new trend DF, let's check the shape, run this code so that I can check the shape of this trend DF. Remember, our before running this code, what was the shape? The shape of trend DF was 4459 and 4737. So this is important. This is 4737 were the number of column names or feature names. And now I am removing those duplicated ones. So let's check the new shape. And do you see that 4737 remains constant? So that means there is no duplicated column names indeed. All right. So okay, we are done with this step. It's good that there is no duplicated column name. So now we can move on to the next one, and in the next step I'm going to remove all the sparse data from the entire training data frame. Now there are a couple of different ways to handle sparse data in Pandas, and Pandas also provides a function like sparse array to handle sparse data set, but for the purpose of this project and this notebook, I'm going to take the simpler approach, which is just to drop the sparse data from the training data set and also from test data set. So this is a function. This is a code here. So what I'm doing here is very simple. I'm defining a function which will take these two data frame. One is train data frame and one is test data frame, and then remove the sparse data from those two data frames. And how it is removing this? First, this variable column list to drop data from. So this is the whole column list which will be checked that if they have sparse data. And again, I'm excluding ID and target, just like in the previous step while checking for constant variance, that I did not include ID and target here as well. For obvious purpose, I'm excluding ID and target for all the column list which will be checked if they have sparse data. And then I'm looping through this column list to drop data from. With this code, that is I am making use of this numpy.unique function. So basically I am removing those columns where the unique values of those columns, that is if you look at a particular column and vertically look at all their values, those unique values, if they are less than 2, that means it's a sparse column. That column has only sparse data, that is they don't have unique values, that many unique values at all. Basically their values are just like single value, in this case it's probably 0. So that I am removing, and so so after finding those kind of columns which satisfies this condition, that is unique is less than 2, then I'm just removing that column in place equal to true, both from train and test, and then this function returns me the train data frame and the test data frame. So with this function ready, I can just invoke this function and supply it the two arguments, that is my original train DF and test DF. Let's run it. All right, now with this run, that's done, that is all the sparse columns are removed indeed from my train and test. And now that my data pre-processing is done, I am ready to do all the modeling part of the three gradient boosting model that I planned for, that is XGBoost, LightGBM and CatBoost. But before that, I have to split the training data set. So let's do that. So this is my code. So standard code, pretty simple. I'm just structuring the Xtrain and Xtest data set by dropping from the X-train, I'm dropping ID and target, because X-train has within it included ID and target, but it should not have that because it's only the feature. It should not have the target variable. So I'm dropping them. And Y-train is similarly, I'm just, Y-train is just the Y target vector. It will have only the target array values, but note that I'm using log 1p. I'm actually taking the natural logarithm of the target values, because like we saw in earlier plotting, the target values are extremely right skewed distribution. So a lot of values towards smaller end and very low number of values towards higher end. So taking in this kind of the skewed distribution of target variable, it's better to take a natural logarithm. Than if you read the documentation of NumPy as log 1p, it clearly says that these mathematical function calculates natural logarithmic value of x plus 1, where x belongs to the input array elements. And what is my input array elements? This is my target values, this vector, that is all the values of the target column. These log 1p will apply this function, that is log x plus 1, on each element of that vector, of that target column values. And that will be my y trend. And then the x test original, again, I'm just dropping the ID from my test data frame. And then I'm applying this train test split function of scikit-learn to split my x train into test, x test, y test, and x train, y train. I have named that here as x validation, but it's actually x test. I just had to give a different name to properly differentiate it from some other names that I have used here. So yeah, I should actually just print the shape of these x train and x validation, all these things, to check that these splitting was done properly. And I have choose test size as 0.2. That means 20% of my data would be test data and the 80% will be my train data. Okay, I just printed the shape of each of these data arrays after splitting them. And as you can see, that x train split is kind of expected, 4735 features. X validation as well, 4735 features. So these two should be the number of features should be equal indeed. And the both two y train, they are a single array vector. So that's what I'm getting here. 3567 here as well for x train, and y train as well, 3567, and the other number also matches. X validation, I have total 892 samples. And here as well, 892 samples. All right, now my full preparation is ready to run my first model, which is LightGBM. But let's first understand the fundamental need of boosting algorithm, or where they fit in. So a basic question, let's say our first model predicts a data point incorrectly, and so does the second model, and say a whole sequence of model predicts a data point incorrectly. But then if I combine those individual prediction, will the combination works better for the prediction? So boosting answer this kind of question. Basically, boosting works on the principle of sequence and the principle of ensemble, where each subsequent model improves the error of the previous model. And among the three gradient boosting algorithm that I'm going to apply, the first one is going to be LightGBM. So here, before doing the actual code, a quick word on these LightGBM, that it's a gradient boosting model that makes use of tree based algorithms and is considered to be a fast processing algorithm. While in other gradient boosting algorithms, trees grow horizontally, in LightGBM, the trees grow vertically, meaning it grows leaf wise while the other algorithms grow level wise. A very important point to note. And LightGBM chooses the leaf with large loss to grow, and it can lower down more loss than a level wise algorithm when growing in the same leaf. So this is a pictorial representation of that LightGBM actually grows leaf wise while other grows level wise. And now finally, the LightGBM model training with my train data that was split in a previous step. This step is actually simpler than you think, because here I'm just actually implementing from the LightGBM documentation their parameter and some default and some standard values of LightGBM. So let's check it out. So this is going to be my So this is the code. So here I'm just defining a function that will run my entire LightGBM model with these parameters, and then ultimately return me the y predicted value on the predicted test values of my target variable. So if you quickly, let's quickly move through the actual what they're doing. So these params are just taken from the documentation. You can look over their documentation here, very well explained, and there are thousands of blogs on explaining these parameters of LightGBM, because these algorithms are so popular. Anyway, so so after defining these parameters, and I'm not going in the details of these parameters because the documentation will be the best source for you to read through them, that what these objective is and bagging fraction, etc. So after defining these parameters, I am just passing my train data set and validation data set. Remember, we already developed this data set in here after applying the train test split. So I have x train split, x validation, y train split, y validation, and also my x train and y train from the original data. Okay. So so lgb.dataset, I am passing the train data set and a validation data set, and then I am running the train function, which will actually train the LightGBM model on this data set and using these parameters again, the early stopping rounds 150, and then these are standard the standard numbers I have used here. You can again go through their documentation, it's really recommended. And then finally, after this training, I am ultimately returning from this function this is the most important return value of this function, the predicted test LightGBM. So this is my predicted y value after doing the entire training. And again, this line I'm using these np.expm1. If you look at the documentation, what this will do is, so I just put comments to understand what this expm1 is doing. So let's quickly understand what how I'm getting these predicted y values. So in this step, my training is done, and then after my training is done, then I can apply the model to predict the values of target columns on test dataset. Remember, test dataset did not have any target column, because that's what we are supposed to, that's the whole purpose of doing the entire exercise, that we have to get the target values on our test data set. So here in this line, that's what I'm doing, that applying this after the model is trained, and applying the predict function on the trained model, and passing this test x, which is my test data set, and that will give me the target y values of test data set. Then that entire target y values is captured in this expression, but that expression is being passed through these numpy expm1, and what this expm1 is doing, it is just an exponential calculation function. So it calculates exponential of all elements, subtracting one from all the input array elements. So it's an element wise operation, and so the output array consists of element wise exponential value minus one corresponding to each input element. And this function, why this function is used, is because this function this function provides a greater precision than just simply using expx minus one for small values of x. So basically, the expm1 function avoids a loss of precision involved in the direct evaluation of expx minus one for small values of x. All right, so now that I have got my predicted y values, I am ready to return that from the function. And then this is just a definition of this entire function, but now I have not run this function yet. And that's what I'm going to do in the next cell, which is, and the code for actually invoking this function on my actual dataset is this, that I'm running this LightGBM model run that was defined here, and passing all my data that so these first part is all the split data set, and the last one is a X test original. Remember these predicted Y values. These will be calculated based on these X test original that is given in a separate CSV file in the original competition. So I think it, if I run this, it is going to take a while. One second. LGB LIG. Okay, I have not run this cell, and that's why it is saying that. So let's run this cell first. Okay. And now I'm running this cell. Okay, it has started running. I think it's going to take a while to do the entire light GBM on these. I think we had a 4,300 rows or samples of data, so it is going to take a while. And once the LGBM training is over, you will get this kind of output. Note one thing: the RMSE error, which is a metric I have chosen during my LGBM function, that is continuously getting reduced. And why RMSE? Because this is a regression problem, and in the parameters you have to assign a metric for your loss function. And so I have chosen here root mean squared error, this RMSE, as my metric. And so that's a metric the whole LGBM is trying to reduce throughout its training. So initially I look at this, my RMSE it was getting is 1.66, and then continuously after training at the end, towards the end, it was getting 0.79 or something similar. And then actually it started increasing, and that's why it invoked the early stopping technique here, because that was the best iteration or best RMSE it was it received. Okay, so that was my LGBM training, light GBM training. And what is important from this training is these particular value that I have to keep saving, this particular value, because like we decided that I will be running light GBM, CAD Boost and XGBoost, and then combine them and do an ensemble of those three algorithm to get my final prediction value to submit to the competition. So after each training, this is my prediction from that particular training, and I have to keep track of them, because I have to run my I have to do the ensemble at the end from these variable. So after light GBM, I'm going to run now XGBoost, and I have already prepared this notebook. Actually in my notebook I have put a lot of notes to understand. I definitely will put a link to this notebook in my GitHub and also in my Kaggle, and put that in the description of the video, so you can take a look at that. Because in the notebook I have put some extra note on the fundamental flow or understanding XGBoost, light GBM and CAD Boost, and also what is the difference between XGBoost versus light GBM or light GBM versus CAD Boost. So for now, just move on to XGBoost model training. This is all the notes that is in my notebooks. These maths are nothing to be scared of. You do not really have to implement this math, because it's already implemented in this superbly popular XGBoost library that I'm going to use here. And so let's go to my XGBoost model. And here again, I'm defining a function to do the entire training. And that function will return me the predicted Y values from my test data set, and then I will be applying this function on the actual data set. So this is the function. The structure is again similar to LightGBM, that I am first defining all these parameters, for which you will get details understanding if you go to XGBoost official documentation. That's really beautiful documentation they have written over there. You will get a lot of explanation on each of these parameters, so I'm not wasting time here to go over them again here. All right, so this is the parameters with which my XGBoost model will run, and then I'm defining the training data and the validation data. And again, this train data is this train X that will be supplied later in the next cell. So my training data and validation data is defined here. And then I am running the model xgb.train. With this, the model will be trained completely, and the output of the training is captured in this variable model underscore xgb. And then again, finally, after training the model, I will get the predicted y values after the model training, and that y value is what I'll be returning from the function. And again, just like the LightGPM, I'm making use of this expm1 of NumPy. And all right, so now that's my function, and in the next cell I'm just applying or invoking this function or executing this function indeed, and passing my split data set and also my x test original, and that will give me this predicted y test original of xgbm model. And again, we'll be running Ensemble at the end, so we have to keep track of these particular variable, the most important, that is a predicted target value. And okay, so that was xgb. Like I said, that it's not the running the actual algorithm on the dataset is relatively easier and simple, because you have the beautiful and optimally coded packages, XGB libraries to help you. And if you just go through their documentation, well, you will know exactly all the details, and you need to apply those modules of those libraries. Feature engineering on the data is actually where the difficult part. So again, the note on XGB does not require any introduction. This is one of the clear winner in the history of Kaggle. Many competition, tabular database competition, were won by applying XGBoost. It's really one of the great innovation of the recent years in the machine learning space. All right, now XGB is over. My final model will be CatBoost. In the note, in the notebook, I have provided some fundamentals on the CatBoost. You can go over them in the link that I will provide, so I'm not going over them. And I have also put detailed notes on each of the parameters of CatBoost that it takes and what it significant, what it represent. So let's now go to the code of running CatBoost. Okay, before moving on to CatBoost, I just want to mention a couple of things on two aspects of XGBoost model that I have used here, because XGBoost is so popular and so useful that in your machine learning career you have to use it so many times and throughout your career, so it's best to understand it in as much detail as possible. So the two points I want to talk about is D-matrix and watchlist. So D-matrix is a special type of internal data structure of XGBoost, and it is much more optimized both from memory perspective and also training speed. And creating D-matrix can be created from multiple data sources, and it's so easy to convert our normal pandas data frame to D-matrix, just like what I did here. That D-matrix, I just passed TrainX and TrainY. Similarly, for the validation data, I pass validation X and validation Y. And remember, to create a D-matrix, you have to pass both the features, that is X value and also the target, that is Y values, which is what we are doing here. That is train X, train Y, validation X, validation Y. Both you need to pass to D-matrix to convert your data frame to D-matrix. All right, and the next one is watch list. So watch list is basically, it's a named list of D-matrix dataset to use for evaluating model performance. And how this model performance is evaluated with this parameter. That is, in the original parameter that is passed to the XGBoost model, I am using one particular parameter called eval metric. And in this case, it's RMSE, which is root mean squared error. So this RMSE will be computed when I'm using watch list, these RMSE will be computed for each of these data sets during each boosting iteration, and stored in the end as a field named evaluation log in the resulting object. So that means this RMSE will be calculated for each named data matrix that I have, D matrix that I have provided to watch list. So which are the D matrix I have provided? I have provided training data. This is these data matrix. D-matrix, and I have also provided validation data. This is these D-matrix. So the evaluation will be done based on RMSE on both of these data set for each iteration of XGB. That's what watchlist will do. And XGB.train, this particular function takes watchlist as one of its parameter. So so it's a beautiful way to do the evaluation through the XGB model. I normally always use watchlist while using XGB model. And now, so finally, CAD boost. This is our third algorithm and the last one that will be used for our final ensemble. And this is a code now in this cell. So here I'm not no more using another function, just to be short and simple here, no particular reason. So I'm directly applying CAD boost regressor, and these are the parameters that I am supplying to it. Again, please go through the CAD boost regressor documentation. It's beautifully written, and then there the detailed definition of each of these parameters is provided. And then I'm applying the fit function, which will train the CAD boost based on this parameter on my data set. And what is my data set? That is X train, Y train, and eval set is X validation, Y validation. So these validation set will be used for evaluation of the CAD boost of under each iteration. And when this fit function is done with its work, that is, it is trained, the model is trained, then I'll be predicting my Y test by supplying to the trained model my X test data. And that's what I'm doing in this slide. So my model CAD boost is now completely trained after the fit function is done executing. And then I can apply the predict function on the trained model to predict the actual Y test values from these X test feature names. And again, the whole prediction vector, I'm passing it to EXPM1, like we discussed earlier, to check out, to apply this EXPX-1 function calculation on this. All right, so my CAD boost is also done now. And importantly, just like in LGB and XGB, from CAD boost as well, we got the most important variable here, which is predicted Y test original CAD boost. So this will hold the entire target vector after applying the CAD boost on our test data set. So now I am fully ready to run my ensemble, and this is the final cell, and that's what I'm doing here, ensembling from all the three predictions previously I got from LGB, LightGBM, XGBoost, and CADBoost. So quickly, first, this is the Kaggle page. Just quickly check out the sample submission.csv file that they have given to us. So this is the final submission file that we have to submit to Kaggle to check with their test data. So this sample submission just contains all the unique IDs, unique values of the potential customers, and the target values of the target variable. So this exactly in the same format, we have to submit our submission file as well. And so what I'm doing here, first I'm just doing a pd.readcsv of the original submission file that was given in the competition, that is this sample submission.csv. And remember, I already have downloaded this in my local machine, so here I'm just reading from my local machine. And then I am doing this ensembling here. So first, my the prediction from my LightGBM model. Remember, after running the LightGBM, we got prediction of all the vectors containing the full vector containing the target variable values of the LightGBM, and that was held in this variable. After running the XGB, we got a similar variable, which was this, and after the CAD boost, we got this variable, just like we saw right now in the previous cell. That is, after each of the model, we got a final prediction Y values, and this is these are those variables. And from those variables, I'm just pulling or extracting the target and putting that into a data frame with the pd dot data frame function here. So I have now three data frame with the target variable, that is predicted Y for like GBM for XGB and CAD boost. And finally, my final submission file that is containing the final target values that I'll be submitting to the competition, which will have all the IDs and the corresponding target values, will be 50% from LGB and 30% from the XGB and submission CAD boost, the 20% from CAD boost. And how I arrived these 50%, 30%, and 20% is just pretty much by experiments that I ran quite a few number of times the entire training. And with these particular values, I was kind of getting the best score or the best ranking in the competition. So there is no proper formulas or etc. that I have used here. It is just by trial and error that I have selected this 50%, 30% and 20% for final submission to Kaggle competition. Alright, so this submission final, this is the final data frame that I have to submit, and this will be, and of course I have to submit a CSV file, so I have to convert it to a CSV file, but with this two CSV function of pandas. And so that's pretty much about it. And remember, the final submission file will look exactly like this. That is, it will have the unique IDs of the test and the predicted target values for each of these IDs, and then Kaggle will test the these my prediction with their internal test data set as well, and put me in the give me the ranking in their leaderboard for this competition, or also give me the competition score. So with these, initially I was getting a score of within the top 11% in this competition, which is not super good but not too bad as well. Alright, so that pretty much wraps up this video. And before closing, a quick word that I'll be uploading videos on full-scale projects in machine learning and deep learning. So if you have not subscribed yet, do subscribe. And if you like this video, destroy the like button. All right, see you next time.